worthy. We lift our hands to say thank you.
Good evening. We're back once again. Yes, look like a man. I've seen you before. And hopefully you've seen me. Again, this is Dr. George Lee III with part two, continuation from last week on our series as we deal with the spirituality of humility, James 4:2 says, humble yourselves before God and he will lift you up. And that's what we're going to be continuing to talk about on tonight from James 4 and 10. Share, care, like, love. Comment, let us know that you're connected with us. We appreciate all of your hellos, Sister Deidre, and you know, others, and, you know, all of you all, and I'll be calling your names out. I'm always seeing your names popping up, and I, God knows, appreciate you all the way, even in Kentucky. Campbellsville, Sister LaVeda. LaVeda, that's how y'all pronounce her name, Sister LaVeda Gaddy, down there. So, amen. And sometimes I guess she's even watching us when she's in her own church service. Amen. So, I ain't going to tell you, Pastor, you know, but all is well. Again, so we thank you from all parts of our nation and our world. We thank you for connecting with us. And sometimes the worst times are the best of times because it's allowed us to reach out even further. Let us prepare now for our evening prayer. Whatever you may have going on or dealing with, we believe that we're able to take our burdens to the Lord and leave them there. And not only leaving them there, that if you're spiritual and you're connected to him, he will give you wisdom and strength to deal with anything that you're going through. That when we pray in the name of Jesus, we're able to receive the benefits of the relationship. He says, anything you ask in my name, I will do it, that the Father will be glorified through the Son. So let us pray according to his will. Let us go forth. Lord, we thank you and we love you and we honor you and we bless you for this time and this season, that not in spite of it all, but because of it all, we are still here glorifying your name and building your kingdom here and representing you as citizens. Lord, we're not perfect, but we desire to continuously walk in holiness, which is a lifestyle. We thank you, my master, for the strength that you've given us to help the least, the left out, the lost, and the last. Thank you for opportunities and privileges to let our light shine for men, those that are tuning in. We ask, God, that you allow them to feel your presence. Allow them to know that you are real and that you're with them and that there is, Lord, a strength that is guiding them and leading them as they're going through the valleys of the shadow of death, as they're climbing up mountains, Lord, as they're standing even before mountains, and you're giving them the wisdom and the strength to be able to speak to those mountains and their mood. And so, Lord, we ask that your perfect will be done. Bless those that are in leadership positions from, Lord, the office, Lord, of the presidency, Lord, all the way down to the office of the custodian in each one of our lives and businesses. Lord, bless, Lord, every person, Lord, that may be in leadership, whether we voted for them or not. Everyone is your child. We are part of your family. And we ask, God, that you lead them and guide them, that what they decide, Lord, will be the best, Lord, for your creation. Now, as we go forth and continue this series of humility, we ask, God, that the words of our mouth and meditations of our heart always be accepted in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Bless us in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and the sign of the cross. Somebody type in amen. Amen. Let us pick up where we left off. Sharing with you James 4 and 10 says, you humble yourself before God, that God will lift and raise you up. We're continuing with talking about Benedict. And again, there's some wonderful books out there that we've quoted and shared, specifically in the rule of Benedict. And as we stated, that Benedict from centuries ago was part of a monastic order. He is a venerated saint in the Catholic Church. And the reason why we are quoting and sharing with him, because he was able to bring a sense of balance and discipline to the life, you know, of Christians and people that were going to church and people who thought they were more than other people. And he helped them understand that regardless of what you own or what you have, or regardless of how rich you are, if you don't have a spirit of humility, or if you're not treating people right, As scripture says, you know, everything you have is a sounding brass or tingling cymbal. And so as we share with the rule of Benedict and some of the things that he began to set in order in a disciplined life, we are particularly pulling out this issue of humility and helping us understand what humility is and how humility derives from an awareness and a consciousness that I'm not the only one in the universe. That yes, we are our brothers and sisters' keeper, even if we're not directly, indirectly. That do you know that the decisions that we make, even in our own homes, a lot of times affects your neighborhood, your community, your world? The things that you may decide to do when you leave home to either get revenge, you know, or to get back at others, has a ripple effect in so many ways and means. And that's why it's important that as we go through life, we need to have more of a spiritual awareness of who we are and what we are. We're not just human beings, but we are spiritual entities. And we're able to tap into whether that which is good or whether that which is evil. And then we see what, when we tap into the evil and the bad part, how it causes pain, agony, and strife for all of us, even in ways that are that we're affected indirectly. And so how do we work with this? You know, that when you're dealing with darkness, do you fight darkness with darkness? No. You put more emphasis on the light. That it only takes a spark to get a fire going. And don't you know that you can be in utter darkness? And if you just turn on a little pin light, you can see your way. Isn't that amazing? You know how powerful light is, even in the midst of darkness. That just a little bit of light dispels darkness. And so as we continue in dealing with humility, which is an awareness of self, an awareness of how we treat others, and it is not to make us be abased or to degrade us or to make us think, you know, far less than who and what we are. We believe in self-esteem. We believe that even within our children and all races, that self-esteem should be built and integrated into the lives of children at a very young age, that when they look at themselves, that they should not feel as though that they would want to be another color, another race, or another gender, that they feel wonderful about being who they are. But in that wonderfulness, we also should not use that to be disparaging towards others. That we should not use it to degrade other people. You know, if they don't have what we have, if they don't look like we look. Again, and you know the old adage, you can't judge a book by its cover. You never know until you open it up and see what's inside. And humility allows us that attitude of gratitude to walk in that awareness that everybody is somebody. And that what I'm able to do is by God's grace and mercy. And whatever I have, it is that I can be a blessing to others. And so when we realize that and understand that even in God consciousness, that everything that we do, there is an awareness that God has. That there's nothing that we do is behind closed doors per se. And so, you know, being one way out in public and being another way behind closed doors, you're really not being another way. Because whoever you are when the door is closed is really who you are. When the doors are open, you know, people have just not been around you long enough. Time tells all. And the only perfect people are the ones you don't know. How about that? So, when we're dealing with humility, humility allows us to understand that we all have idiosyncrasies and we all have weaknesses and we all have things that, you know, that causes us to stumble and to fall, and we're really not better than any other individual. And as we work, you know, on treating, you know, our neighbor, who is that neighbor? You know, anyone, you know, that you meet along the street. And so, picking up where we left off from last week, the very consciousness of God in time, as we deal with Benedict's concept of humility, that because God is above time, beyond time, you know, in time, in his created time. The consciousness of God in time is central to Benedict's perception of the spiritual life. But Benedict's position is both shocking and simple. Being sinless, you know, because people want to be perfect. You know, I'm perfect. I don't do this. I don't drink. I don't smoke. I don't play the lottery. I don't do it. You know, but you don't speak to people, you know, on the street. You turn your nose up, you know, at folk. You talk about people behind your back. You gossip, you know, all those things. So don't talk about what it is that you don't do. You may not do some of the things that other people do, but you're doing something. And so when we talk about being sinless or being perfect or not doing, you know, the major sins that everybody else do, that is not enough. Being steeped in the mind of God is most important. As Paul says, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. See, while we restrain ourselves from harsh speech and bad actions and demands of the flesh and pride of the soul, what is most vital to the fanning of the spiritual fire is to become aware that the God we seek is aware of us. You understand that? See, sanctity, in other words, is not a matter of moral athletics or moral calisthenics. Sanctity is a consciousness. And that is just where, you know, God has, for some reason, has had us lately. You know, bringing us into more of an awareness of who and what we are as a people and what we do and how it affects each other. See, sanctity is a conscious relationship with the consciousness, but invisible God. You cannot see God, touch God, but there is a consciousness that you know that there's something about when you do someone wrong that comes over you, that you feel, that you're not running up to people, stabbing people because you don't like them. You know, because there's something that convicts you, that pulls you, that tugs on you. And so that is a conscious relationship. And the theology is an enlivening and enlivening and liberating one. It is not a matter that the posture implies of our becoming good enough to gain the God who is somewhere outside of us. See, it is a matter of gaining the God within us, the love of whom impels us to do good. The question I ask, even if you don't go to church all the time, what is it that keeps you from not knocking everybody's head off who gets on your nerves or who ticks you off? You know, what causes you, you know, to smile at other children and they're not your own? What causes you to, you know, to reach out and want to give someone a hug and you've missed them and you've not been able to hug people in over a year? That all of that allows us to know that there's something inside of us that impels us and desires us to do good or can impel us to do evil. And see, the prophet indicates this to us, showing that our thoughts are always present to God, saying in Psalm 7:10, God searches hearts and minds, and again in Psalm 94:11, the Holy One knows our thoughts. Likewise, in Psalm 139:3 says, from afar you know my thoughts, and my thoughts shall give you praise. Psalm 76:11. Benedict, whose whole way of life is steeped in the Psalms, relies heavily on the Psalms here to prove God's probing presence into the individual soul. God, he's concerned about each one of us, not just corporately, but individually and independently. See, Benedict says quite clearly, you know, that it's within us is to be realized, not outside of us to be stumbled upon. I need to say that again. Benedict says this, that it is within us, what's within us is to be realized, not outside of us to be stumbled upon. It is not a game of hide and seek we play in the spiritual life. No, that's not what it is, that you're trying to seek something that you already have. It is simply a matter of opening our eyes to the light that drives out the darkness within us. The scripture says, you know, that your eyes, that's the light of the soul. That's the entrance of the soul. And when your eyes are open, you know, to have an awareness is what our society now is calling, you know, being woke. Now, that opening of our eyes to the light, that drives out the darkness within us. So how does a person seek union with God? How does that happen? And again, I'm going to wrap this up by saying this. There was a conversation between a teacher and a student was called a seeker. The seeker had been around the various teachers trying to seek and understand what truth is and what this humility that we're talking about. And so, seeker comes to this particular teacher one day and begins to stand in his classroom and, you know, continuously questions and probes. So finally, the seeker asked, how do you get this relationship and this union with God, this invisible God? The seeker asked. The teacher said, the harder you seek, the more distance you create between God and you. Isn't that interesting? That's what the teacher said. He says, the harder you seek, the harder you look, you know, the more distance you create between God and you. So the student said, so what does one do about this distance? So if I'm seeking him more and that's creating a further chasm, what do we do about the distance? The teacher said, first of all, understand that it isn't there, that the distance isn't there. Understand that. So the seeker says, okay. So you're saying that since there is no distance, that God is in me. Oh, I get it. That God and I are one. That's what the seeker thought, the student. The teacher said, no, not one. And not two. The student is baffled. I don't understand. You said that the harder that I seek for God, the more distance there is going to be. And first of all, if I'm going to be close to God to understand that there is no distance, now you're saying that if I'm saying God is in me and I am in him, that we're one, and you're saying no, and if we're not one, that he's not next to me, we're not two. He says, the teacher said, you're not understanding what I'm saying. He said, listen, the sun and its light, the oceans and all of its waves. Ah, listen to the singers and their songs. Sir, it's not one and it's not even two. That's where we are in consciousness. That there's light, and it comes from the sun. But you can't distinguish and saying it's one or it's two. It's distinct, yet it's unified. How many of us have looked at the ocean and seen wave upon wave that is never the same? It's not one, nor it. Is it too? And how many melodious, angelic voices that we hear each and every day sing songs that cause us our hearts to flutter. The singer and their song are not one, neither are they two. Meditate upon that. Understand it. And then you will catch the key to the spirituality of humility. Not one and not two. You desire to be a part of the spiritual family of God, part with us and this wonderful family that we represent. Christ, repeat these words with us. Dear Lord, I'm a sinner. I'm asking you today to become the head of my life. Please forgive me from all of my sins. I believe you died on the cross for me, and 3 days later you were raised from the dead. And because I believe, today I am saved. Now, Lord, please fill me with the gift of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, I'm saved. Not one, not two, but saved. All right? Yes. We're going to talk about that more. But right now, here are the sights and sounds of St. John the Mighty. Blessings to you. Thank you for listening and seeing, giving you a visual of not one nor not two. Now, join us as you continuously support the 3T ministry, the Time, Talent, and Time, St. John, the Mighty Fortress.
There are several ways to give to support the ministries of St. John Baptist Church, the Mighty Fortress, your time, talent, and tithe. We've made virtual giving so easy. Just text St. John SAV to 73256 and follow the prompts. That's St. John SAV 73256 and follow the prompts. Or you can call the number right on your screen to speak to someone and give your credit card information. 912-844-1872. That's 912-844-1872. Or feel free to mail in your cash, donations, and tithes to St. John Baptist Church, the Mighty Fortress, 2415 East DeRenne Avenue, Savannah, Georgia, 31406. And to give your time and talent or to find out more information on everything going on at St. John the Mighty Fortress, including our virtual worship experiences, you can find us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, and Periscope, or go to stjohnsavannah.org.
Blessings to you. Thank you again for sharing with us in this two-part series on the spirituality of humility. And our prayer is that we will have made it plain enough that you began to understand and realize the awareness that now has been given you as it relates to the consciousness of God, as well as our relationships with each other here on earth. Our goal is to bring a sense of positivity and clarity in these trying times of guided missiles and misguided men. So continuously join us every morning for Mighty Fortress Moments right here, as well as on Sundays for Morning Manna, right here. Share and see us on www.stjohnsavannah, as well as listening to us on WSOK right here every Tuesday from 7 to 7:30 for classic and traditional broadcast experience. And when you are in our area, as the sun is shining and the winds are blowing beautiful breezes, come by our drive-in worship service, still being held outside on the beautiful campus of St. John the Mighty Fortress, 2415 East Darden Avenue, the soul of Savannah. Come as you are in the family car every Sunday from 10 to 11 a.m. And until we come back together again, as we always say, look beyond your disabilities, saints, and see the possibilities, and make the possibilities realities in your life, and God will give each of you as far as you can see. Until we meet again, all is well.
Oh, we offer praise today because you are worthy. We lift our hands to say thank you.